First of all, thank you for your time. Congratulations on the new record. Sounds awesome. I actually think it's like a superpower you have of being still current and active and not sounding like that 90s band. It's quite modern, quite dark. So congratulations.
Thank you. That means a lot to me.
I understand that it's like it's some kind of a weight that you carry around your shoulders when you have been very successful in a moment of your career, and then you have to try continually do something different.
Well, it's not so much that you have to do something different, but you are just viewed through a certain lens through which you will never recover. You know, it's just your, it's, I liken it to the experience of being a butterfly. And somebody captures the butterfly and then pins it to a board, and then you can never change and you can never get away. And, you know, your fans in some cases don't want you to change. They want you to just keep doing the one record over and over again. And some artists are remarkably skilled at doing that. You know, they're really good at doing that. I'm just not that kind of person. You know, I want to experience the world in all my different seasons. I don't want to just keep repeating something just to be successful.
Isn't there a way to kind of prepare your fans for that kind of behavior? I mean, for example, if you take AC/DC or Motorhead, there are bands that they take actual pride in doing something similar from one record to another. But then you take, for example, Garbage or Radiohead, and you find another bands that they teach their fans from the very young age that maybe you won't have the same from me one time again, over and over.
I think, to be fair, the loyalty that we've enjoyed from our fans has been astounding. They have stuck with us. You know, there was a period of time when the critics just literally were laughing at us, and we were kind of rejected by mainstream media. The fans stayed with us, and they're still here. You know, and that to me says everything. It's like they're willing to go with the changes. They're willing to experiment with us and willing to indulge us a deviation from the route. And that is an extraordinary privilege, you know, that we enjoy for sure.
Well, maybe I think the 90s were a time where the critics and the journalists were actually important. They could decide whether or not you had access to the main public or not. We have the illusion that something changed, and that now the social media and the internet have made everything more democratic and more accessible. Is that true, or are there still really influencers, to call it somewhere, in some way, that decide over your future and your success?
The influencers are now the social media platforms and streaming services. I mean, mostly it's streaming services that impact your career the most. But the streaming services pay attention to what's being said in the press, you know. So it's kind of like, you're right, music journalism doesn't have the same weight as it once did in the 90s. But streaming services are now the equivalent of MTV. So if you're not getting on the streaming services, you're fucked, basically. So it's complicated. It's very complex. And it's something I used to really worry about. And now I'm just like, fuck it. Fuck it.
Well, yeah, in this last, well, you always have taken political and social stances in your interviews and sometimes in your lyrics. But this last record is especially heavy on that subject, and there are a lot of metaphors around politics, religion, the situation of the world right now, and now you are exposed to a lot of people saying something or having something to say, and actually they can reach you, they can comment you on social media, and they can reach you and you can listen to them if you want to. Do you care what other people think? Maybe not in a disrespectful way, but sometimes engaging a debate or a conversation?
I love debate and I love conversation with people that I know to be intelligent and moral. I'm not going to invest my time in a stranger's comments on the internet. I'm uninterested in trolls. I'm uninterested in random people who I have no idea who they are and what their intentions are. The whole point of this record is I feel we've gotten to a point in our culture that I feel that we're at a tipping point. Somebody has to say something, someone. And if it's going to be me, then it's going to be me. But I can't shut off what I currently am seeing take place in the world, you know. I mean, this unbelievable systemic racism that is just garnering more and more steam. In part thanks to Trump's lunacy and his unwillingness to address imbalances in society, you know. But it's all over the world. It's not just in America. It's not just in Chile. It's not just in Argentina. It's not just in Scotland. It's everywhere. And I just can't, in good faith, knowing that I'm in my middle age now, I cannot turn away. I can't afford to turn away. I don't want to turn away. I want to look it dead on and go, this is wrong. And I am not signing up to anything other than the dismantling of sexism and racism and misogyny and the abuse of the planet, you know, simply because people want to make money and be rich in their lifetime. And I look at all these politicians and I'm in despair. It's like, what the fuck do you think is your job? Like, what the fuck do you think is your job? Your job is to work for the people, but you're just working for yourself. I can't stomach it any longer. I cannot stand it any longer. It's obscene.
You talk in the lyrics of Wolves about feeding one wolf and attacking the other. I don't remember the exact words. Is this related to this that you're talking about? Maybe we have to make some compromises with some things we don't like in order to tear down the ones that we really don't like?
I think we should all try and reach for the best version of ourselves, because it's so tempting to be the worst version of ourselves. I'm the worst version of myself all the time.
And how do you fight that? How do you try to be the better version of yourself?
Well, as I've gotten older, I've calmed down a bit. So I guess I try and remind myself of kindness. You know, the song No Gods, No Masters starts with the phrase, be kind. You know, kindness is really an underrated virtue. In an age where on the internet, everyone's gotten really sassy and quick and kind of like, poof, I just shut you down. And it's become a sport, right? Social media has become a sport. Unfortunately, we have lost all etiquette, which was placed, you know, etiquette was brought into play to avoid human beings killing each other in the street with guns. That's why we developed etiquette. Mm-hmm. Unfortunately, with social media, all etiquette is out the window, and we're coming back to a time when there's so much conflict between people. Because we're all careless and we're all unkind. And I think somehow or other we need to figure out a way of readdressing the balance so there is respect. Because without that, we're all going to end up in civil war.
Well, we saw a lot of that. I believe that that's what inspired that song, right? Some experiences you had in Chile. But we saw it in Venezuela, we saw it in Colombia, we saw it in the United States, we saw it everywhere.
Yeah, I was very inspired by my visit and it changed me irrevocably. I will never be the same. After my visit to Santiago, when I saw not just the people protesting the government, but I also sat down with a lot of women who had lost loved ones to the Pinochet dictatorship. And when you start to view that abuse of power, to see it with your own eyes, to hear it with your own ears, to learn of the suffering of the people at the hands of people that are supposed to be representing them and improving their lives and instead are basically stealing from them. That is a very difficult pill to swallow. And it ignited something in me And I don't think we would have made the record that we have made had I not come to Chile at that time of the people's protests and the revolution, basically, of the people in Chile against, you know, the disparity between rich and poor.
Before we started the interview, we were talking about some female artists in Argentina. Actually, even though I love the record, I actually had a blast with the B-sides of the record. The song Girls Talk is amazing. The cover of Because the Night with Screaming Females is amazing. You have always endorsed young female artists. You have always gave them a place in your shows, in your records. So I wanted to ask you who gave that hand to you, who you looked up for, because I believe that now there are like more references to take, more role models to see and to look up for, to. And now, when you were a kid, who did you look at?
I was very fortunate in that I had remarkable taste when I was young. And I picked four racing horses. I picked Patti Smith, Debbie Harry, Chrissy Hind, Susie Sue, Stevie Nicks. And all these women have gone on to have phenomenal careers. The person that taught me the most about sharing and being generous towards other artists was Debbie Harry, who, when I was very, very young, my first band that I was in opened for Debbie Harry in the 1980s, in 1983, I think, in the United Kingdom. And Debbie Harry was on a solo tour of her own in the UK, and we supported her. And that's when I first met Debbie Harry. Mm. And then I had another band called Angelfish, who performed with the Ramones at the Academy in the New Music Seminar in New York in 1991, I think.
Nice.
And I'm on stage and I'm really nervous and I haven't really done very much performing. And I look into the audience and in the mosh pit is Debbie Harry.
What? Really?
And she has mentored me my whole career and shared the stage with me. I've been invited to perform with her. She's invited the band Garbage to open for Blondie and so on and so forth. I can't put into words how much she's taught me about the importance of women supporting other women. That there is enough
touring
space.
With Blondie, right?
Yes, yes.
You're
again.
Yeah,
we're doing that in autumn in the UK.
How do you feel about returning to the stages?
Excited. I'm excited.
Has it ever been so long without being on stage in your career?
Yeah, it has. There has been. During the Garbage took a big hiatus in 2007. So yeah, I'm accustomed to not being on stage. But I'm looking forward to it. I mean, it's like what I'm supposed to be doing with my life. I'm like literally like a racehorse in a stall, fucking kicking and going mad. Like I'm bored. And I went to see my doctor yesterday and I said to my doctor, "Doc, I just don't feel good. I just don't feel good." And he went, "You need to work."
You know, it's quite the opposite for so many people. When you feel bad, you need to stop working. You're like a privileged person to have that problem.
I am very privileged. Yes, yes, it's very true.
Are there? I know it's a utopia we're talking here, but are there any plans to come to South America?
I sincerely hope so. Hopefully next year, not this year, but hopefully next year. It is my intention to return with the band for sure, simply because I feel like this record was partly inspired by my trips to South America, mm-hmm. by the Argentinian women, you know, by as I said, what I experienced in Santiago. So yes, I bloody well hope so. I hope so. My prayers are made.
Just to give them a place in the interview, because we talked about it before we started, which Argentinian artist do you like or are you in touch with?
Well, Lady Never Tells, but, you know, I love the people that I've met, the musicians I have met in Argentina have influenced me, and I've thanked them on the record. So if you're curious, you can find it on the record liner notes. Nice. But it's been a profound experience, you know, and to speak with artists who come from a place that isn't the center of the music industry is very fascinating. You know, their stories are different. Their perception of the world is different. And I've learned so much, you know, from my friends, and continue to.
Nice. Just the last one before I liberate you. You can go on with your nice insight.
I'm already liberated, darling.
That's not for me to decide. That's right. I hope we all were. I understand that you started the songwriting process before the pandemic, that the songs were really tied up, and then the pandemic came. What changed in the songs? Because between the songwriting and the recording, some weird things happened in the world. So what changed? Did the songs actually take the shape of what was happening? Is the record darker or angrier than before it was recorded?
No, it was recorded and finished 2 weeks, basically. Well, no, it was. We had two more weeks to finish the record when lockdown in Los Angeles occurred. We only had I had a vocal to record and some backing vocals, but the record was already written, which is what makes this record so peculiar, because it sounds like we've just responded to everything that happened during the course of the pandemic when we were all locked in our homes and watching what was happening in the world. It wasn't like that at all. The record had been written before the pandemic, which is
I understood.
Freaky.
I read some interview with Butch, and I understood that the songs were written, but they were actually recorded later, and that was because why I asked.
He's confused, or there's a language problem.
No. Maybe there is. Is it the way you normally work?
Yeah, kind of. I mean, we had written the songs, some of which were done up in Palm Springs, and then we came down to the studio in Los Angeles to record properly, and some of the songs were written there, but everything was done before the pandemic.
It's kind of frustrating because I understand you wrote a song based on the killing of a black young man in United States, and then when George Floyd happened, everybody thought that you had written that song because of George Floyd, but you had written because another man, and before there was another one, and after it was another one. So suddenly it doesn't matter who or why did you write that song, because it happens all the time, right?
Exactly. I mean, my first memory, let me put it this way. I am embarrassed and ashamed of my tardiness in realizing my own privilege and my own whiteness and not paying attention to the black and brown struggle and of indigenous peoples. I was oblivious to it. Now, granted, part of that is the system wants white people not to pay attention. We're taught not to pay attention. So there is a part of it that is, you know, we too are victims of the white patriarchy, you know. But there's still no excuse that I just didn't pay attention. I wasn't listening. I wasn't watching. And then the young man, Trayvon Martin, a beautiful 17-year-old kid, gets gunned down by an adult in a housing, gated community, and shot to death. And the idiot that did it was clearly racist and got off with murdering a kid. Because he used his defense was essentially a racist defense, and it was accepted by the sort of the predominantly white jury. And I was just astounded that this man got away with gunning a 17-year-old boy down in the street. And then I started paying attention. And then once you start paying attention, and once you start educating yourself about colonialism and systemic racism, you'll never ever recover from it. It's astounding. And it's woven into every single thread of society, you know. It's astounding.
Well, thank you very much for your time, Shirley, really, and for taking the time to really answer the questions. Thank you very much.
You're so welcome. Thank you very much.
If I can only ask you just one little thing, it's to say hello to our radio station. It's called Urbana Play.
Urbana Play?
Yeah, that's right.
Hi, this is Shirley Manson, and you're listening to Urbana Play.
Thank you very much, and congratulations.
You're so welcome. Stay safe. Lots of love.